You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Oh, okay. Little things in life. It's the little things in life that make you happy. And I came into the studio, and Alex drilled a hole in the table.
Uh-huh.
You like that hole?
I mean, do you think that he personally drilled that hole? I think that maybe he got a new hole. I don't know. Or this has already been in there.
Listen, I'm an expert on holes in wooden objects that are...
Oh, I bet you've gotten some splinters on that dick. Bet you have.
Mom, just... anyway.
Can a wooden doll divorce you, too? Or is that just real women?
You know, David Letterman used to have his mother on. This is my mother. Hi, Mom.
Hi. I'm very disappointed.
with me.
With what you've done with your life.
I know. But you...
Okay. No, I'm glad you got rid of all those dumb whore wives. They sucked. They were never good enough for my boobala. I should be holding Kegel. I always get it mixed up.
My mom, you always did. So you were supposed to make Kegel.
But I would squeeze my pussy over you. Your tight young fingers. This is not going well. I've got
to go. You used to say to my kids, you want to taste my Kegel.
Do you want to taste some of Grammy's Kegel?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
they did. And what did they think?
They said...
A little more savory than they were expecting, I think.
They used to say it's tight. Now, Mom, you're eating bacon.
I brought bacon to your Jew podcast.
What are you eating? Is that turkey bacon?
It's regular bacon. It's two sides of bacon because the store next to my house likes to only give me two pieces of bacon.
You're eating bacon and a banana.
And a banana because I can't eat eggs and I can't eat a lot of things because it makes me diarrhea.
It gives you diarrhea.
Mm-hmm. But you know that, son.
So, should we talk about diarrhea?
Yeah.
I have a theory about diarrhea.
Let's hear it.
I think it's a New York phenomenon.
Okay.
I think that you have 12 million people living on top of one another, and there isn't enough Purell.
There's like trickle-down diarrhea. Do you think diarrhea has ever leaked through a ceiling? Because I know like pee and shit has, but like actual diarrhea. You know what I'm talking about? When like a toilet's not in? They haven't like bolted the toilet in enough? I feel like you're laughing too hard at this. I was asking just a regular question.
I know. It's just like when my... Well, it's... I could talk about... All I want to do is talk about diarrhea.
I'll talk about... Half my set's about diarrhea, and now I don't have diarrhea anymore, and I like don't know who I am. I'm like, do I have to start poisoning my body again so I can have a fucking brand? I don't want the people to get confused. Does she have diarrhea or not? But I was doing daily diarrhea diaries for a while.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Your daily really?
I did it for 2 days. I have ADD. Things don't really last. I don't have much follow-up. I did too. They weren't even on consecutive days. I just spit bacon onto your...
Annie Lederman.
It's Letterman. But we can talk about that for a sec. The pronunciation. Because I know you're a Jew and Jews, I don't know, have problems with everything. But... I wanted to explain the pronunciation of my last name.
Okay.
My dad's father pronounced it Lederman, but we don't like him. So my dad changes to Letterman, and we just say Letterman now. He was a dick. Bye. So then that's how you legally don't have to change your last name if you want to disown a family member. You just change the pronunciation.
Well, we'll talk about Father's Day.
Mm-hmm.
Your dad, you get along with your dad.
He's my number one, my favorite person.
That's amazing.
I feel bad for my mom. She knows. I bought a necklace that says mom on it just to like try to make her feel better about it. But she knows I want a dad necklace and I want it to be a little bit bigger.
And when you're hanging upside down from the Vietnamese spin chair, it says, wow. So it's not really mom.
That's true. With my family. On family vacation, that when they spin me upside down.
Letterman.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Like as in Dave Lederman.
It's like Dave Lederman, but I would say no T's, one D is what I used to say when you were allowed to say tranny, because then they could remember tranny Annie, no T's, one D.
Right.
But then I did have a guy, I said that to a male flight attendant once, who was
I don't call you a comedian.
You just call him
I call you a comic. Why do you have to say male flight attendant?
Why can't you
say homosexual American?
Listen, I'll tell you, it turns out he was straight, because I got an email. Because my email is just my name. Oh, fuck. Nobody email me, please. But, shit. But so he emails me after I met him and I said that thing. And he's like, hey, I looked up your email and I wanted to email you. And I was just curious, is that true? So this was this older flight attendant man who I guess thought that I really was like a trans girl. And he was like, I'm going to be your papa.
Wow.
And I had to write him back and be like, I was totally just kidding, but thank you for reminding me how small my tits are, that was very beautiful, and how broad my shoulders are. I was obviously a swimmer, but I did not swim into pussies as a man, ever. Just as a woman. Just a nice college grad.
So a woman who's very attractive
invited
me over to watch television.
This is unbelievable.
I know. Me. In the apartment.
Okay.
She wants to watch the Tonys with me.
She thinks you're gay.
I said, are we going to eat donuts and talk about...
Is that
about-
eat her out? Is that the... You're like, are we going to eat donuts? As in your whole? It's so annoying when comics go blue. I hate it. Anyway, go ahead.
Don't you think if a woman who's very attractive feels safe, feels that I'm safe enough to come over... And watch the Tonys with her. She thinks I'm gay.
How old is she, though?
I don't want to get into specifics.
No, but just, is she younger or older than...
She's
relatively, like...
Well, everybody's relatively...
A lot younger than you.
Everybody's a lot younger
than I am. You might have gotten into the dad zone, which is something men of your age... I've never said that before, and I'm 100% writing a joke about this. But if you get in the dad zone where it's like, oh, we see you as a father figure. You guys are always trying to fuck us when we're young. And then, so we don't know that you're trying to bang us. We don't know that, because you're a comedian, and comedians can get laid different than other guys, right?
Why?
Because you're funny. You have a currency that's not the same as other men.
Tell me about the dad zone.
The dad zone.
I don't want to be in the dad. That's creepy.
Then fuck some bitches your own age, asshole.
That's right.
So.
But are there women who have daddy issues that they resolve with?
Yeah, for sure. I think they do. Obviously. I mean.
Don't you think... Let me ask you this. Do you think most women have unresolved daddy issues the same way? Because Freud refused to touch on this. He just threw up his hands, said, I don't know what women want. Give me some cocaine.
Yeah. He's like, I love coke.
Because even Freud couldn't figure out women. And I'm not, I know you don't speak for all women, but do you think, given that all men have mommy issues, don't you think all women have unresolved daddy issues?
Yeah, we have daddy issues. We have mommy issues. We all, there's like, I don't know, for me, I obviously can only speak for myself, but for sure, big issues with my dad. But I also have like weird shit with my mom. I think parents are just hard, but I'm really lucky. I have the best.
Right, but fathers, we should move on. But
we can keep going.
Okay, I think a mother can smother a son.
The old mother smother.
The mother smother.
Mm-hmm. And it's my favorite wrestling move. It's when you take your kids and you offer them Kugel, but you Kegel on them. This mother smother.
The mother smother.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody says that's creepy. Nobody will ever say it's creepy that a mother smothers and controls her son. There's nothing creepy about, it's not healthy. A mama's boy, he's a mama's boy. But... This is just my prejudice. This is just what I think. I think a father who's tries to smother his daughter is
trying to fuck.
There's something a little creepy about that.
And it's more possession and like treating your daughter as like an object that you want to protect and keep a certain way, but she's like her own person.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
but I don't know. This is about,
hang on. This is important to me, and I'm not trying to. But this is you agree that you meet me, right?
Mm-hmm. Dad zone immediately.
Okay. If I told you, I'm a bit of a mama's boy. My mother controls my life. I talk to her three times a day. I have to take her shopping. I'm taking her to play poker tonight. I take my mother to the movies. This is how I see it. It's creepy. It's disgusting. But you get it.
Yeah, we saw Psycho. We saw the movie. We know you're dragging around a corpse, dude. Why are people so cool with you dragging this corpse to fucking poker night?
Oh, my God. Hang on.
Take a breath.
I'm being serious. Be serious.
Okay, I don't know.
You don't think the mother's trying to bang the son, though, right?
I don't think the father is always trying to bang the daughter, unless we're talking about the president, but it's like, I mean, do you see her recoil? Do you see her recoil?
Hang on, I just laughed, and here's what Siri said.
Which email address from Matt Geiler? sickpicnic@gmail.com or Matt Geiler.
My laugh, Siri takes my laugh at, hey Siri, hang on. Hey Siri, can you give me email address? That's what my laugh sounds like.
But I liked his email address, was good. What was it? No, I put my email in. He puts his. Everybody email him instead of me. My inquiries go through that guy's email.
Hey, has anybody done a bit about Siri talking back to you while you're having sex? Somebody must have done that.
Probably.
Because I don't know how to turn Siri off. And I laughed and she thought I was asking for this Matt Geiler guy.
What do you think Siri would think your sex sounded like?
I will call 911.
Is someone dead in the room? I sense no movement. There's some light weeping. And it's male, unfortunately.
I'll order new sheets immediately. Yes. So I'll move on. But
no, we can talk about it. I feel like you have something you want to say.
No. I want to know your opinion that if a man says, blah-bitty, 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 my mother, my mother, my mother, my mother. I lived with my mother until I was 80. Now I'm ready to date.
You're 80?
Yeah.
Oh. Look a little older than that. I would have guessed like 82.
I had work done.
I love hurting men, but it just feels so good. You know, so I have a twin brother and I was born breech after him.
What does breech mean?
I came feet first, but he was born first, regular, head first. So I came feet first, which means that I kicked him out of the womb, which I thought was a joke. And my mom was like, no, the doctor said you kicked him out. So I was just born to emasculate men. But it emasculates my brother if I call him a woman. So there you go.
Tell me about Father's Day. Your dad has a ponytail.
Well, he grew out his mullet for family vacation. He just knows how to be fun. He knows what's going to be good. So he grew out a mullet for family vacation. My mom cuts his hair. And so I just put in a ponytail and he just left it in for the whole day. And it was really exciting.
First marriage?
Mm-hmm.
Your parents have been married for
44 years, I think.
That's amazing.
Yeah, my dad was working at Penn, or he was going to Wharton or something. And he was in his early 30s. I think he might have been 30 or 31. And my mom was going to Tufts in Boston. And they both were friends with opposite sexes of a couple. And the couple hated them as third wheels, so they set them up.
Oh.
And then so they met up, and then they dated only for like 6 months long distance and then got married. My mom was only 22. So they're 9 years apart.
And you're Quaker, so they're from Pennsylvania.
Well, my dad's from upstate New York and my mom's from near the Connecticut border of New York, but she just decided to raise us Quaker. She worked at a Quaker school and liked it. So when we were two.
And Quakers, it comes from quaking. It's almost like a clitoral orgasm, right?
Well, I'm always masturbating in Quaker meetings. So,
but don't you quake? Isn't there like a quake?
Yeah.
What does quaking mean?
So originally it was about that everyone sits in silence facing each other. And it's supposed to be that God is speaking through you and you're moved to speak. So you stand and speak. But it was a little crazier back in the day. So
in your day or back?
I don't know when.
When Ben Franklin was doing it.
Yeah, I mean, probably definitely before him. I don't really know the timeline of Quakerism. I'm pretty chill on learning facts. So I'm mm-hmm. pretty like relaxed and laid back about any sort of learning or knowledge. But
Barbara Bush, I'm doing a joke, by the way. Just attention, everybody. I'm about to make a joke.
We know because you get your, Barbara Bush.
Uh-huh. Barbara Bush is Quaker.
Really?
Well, she's on the Quaker Oats box.
Do you remember when he told me it was a joke and then I still believed him? I was like, what? Are you serious?
I'm done.
She is.
I'm done making my
but
joke.
But then it was throwing me into telling you about there's programmed and unprogrammed Quakers. So Quakerism believes that God's in the form of an inner light. And I'm unprogrammed Quaker. So it's God's in the form of an inner light that's in everyone and everything.
Right.
So that's why we're pacifists. And everything's chill and we're trying to be kind and whatever.
Richard Nixon was a Quaker.
Yeah, well, I mean, then there's unprogrammed Quakers. So I don't know which one he was. I'm assuming he was unprogrammed. But
Do you wear buttons?
No, it's not Amish. I think a lot of people think Amish.
I thought Quakers
don't churn butter.
No, I thought Quakers aren't allowed to wear anything militaristic.
Yeah, I guess you're not supposed to wear, but you can do whatever you want in Quakerism because Quakerism is all about openness and inner light and stuff. So you can be gay, Jewish, you can be anything you want. You can be a non-believer. You can be anything.
So I could become a Quaker.
Yeah. You can go to Quaker meeting whenever you want, have a good time.
Is Jesus part of this? Because that's the deal killer for me.
I mean, it doesn't have to be. I mean, I remember like going to Quaker meeting every Sunday and there was one woman who ran the first day of school who would make us color in like Jesus stuff. But I don't know anything. Nobody ever taught me anything about the Bible or brought it up to me ever other than her.
But you understand that the Jesus thing is...
Because you killed him.
We didn't kill him. We hired the Romans.
You gave him a good run for his money though, didn't you? You didn't kill him. Technically the nails killed him, but we didn't kill him.
Right. My Uncle Murray was there and he said, fold his legs.
So we have a Murray?
Yeah. Just tell him to cross his legs so we could use one nail. Don't waste.
That's a good Jew joke.
Benjamin's. Huh?
Do you have an Uncle Murray? Such a good Jew name.
I know. Which is...
Murray.
Murray. No,
but see, I'm from Philly, so Murray. And then...
By the way, the Jesus thing is just, whatever it is, I'm against it.
Yeah.
Whatever you're for... So, in other words, if you're for Allah, I'm against it. If you're for Jesus, I'm against it.
All right, Bill Maher, let's hear that hard R.
Ooh. Go ahead.
I was just making fun of your racism.
No, you just threw me.
I threw you?
Yeah, that got me.
Sorry. All right, I don't want to got you.
So,
but yeah, it's creepy for moms. I mean, it's creepy for both, I guess.
I want to talk about Quakers.
Oh, and then so you were supposed to have shaking because God was speaking through you, but nobody's shaking. People are just talking. But my brother told me that I was just hanging out with my twin brother because his daughter was turning 5. She's so cute. Shout out to Reese. I hope you enjoyed all this other stuff I talked about. I'll talk about squirting later. Pegging. I can't wait to teach you about pegging, girl.
I thought you already talked about squirting.
I'm squirting out of my butt. I'm a butt squirter. Every time I come, I just diarrhea out of my ass.
I'm so glad you're here.
I'm glad I'm here, too. I'm excited to do your podcast.
This is great.
But so...
Your dad. It's
my brother said no. But so my brother said that when we would go to Quaker meeting, I would stand up and say like really profound shit. And I always thought I would talk about like Somalia. Like I would hear like something on the news, and then I would just I don't know. I liked to do that. But he said that I would stand up. He said once I stood up and I went. Do you ever think
how old were you?
Probably like third grade.
Okay.
And I was like, do you ever sit in bed at night and think about how? It's so crazy that you're you and that there's all these other universes. I don't know if I said universes. There's all these other people living all these other lives and they're them. And thinking about how it's their life and like my teachers could not be my teachers, but they are. Do you ever think about that? And that's something I still think about all the time. But it was funny my brother brought it up to me because it was like a question I was about to pose while we were smoking weed around a fire. It was so fun. It was like a fire pit, my brother. Like it was just like so fun.
Mm-hmm.
I probably shouldn't say that because my brother family members.
You're younger than your brother.
I'm 6 minutes younger than him, but we're born at midnight, so we have two different birthdays.
Wow.
Yeah. I kicked him out on one day, and then I was born the next.
And being younger, I'm being serious, are you more of the rebel than he is? Usually the older sibling is more of the control freak and speaks for the parents.
Well, I have an older brother, too. So my older brother's 3 years older than there's Max and then me. But I was for sure the juvenile delinquent and stuff like that. But I was also the only girl. I think being the only girl faced some things in life that men and boys don't have to deal with very young.
Like what?
Just being, I don't know, like
Having to pee sitting down?
No, molested, assaulted, treated inappropriately by adults all the time. I think
that just happened
just
in the last 5 minutes.
And that was just from this grandpa. No, but just like, you know, fucked up shit. And
did fucked up shit happen to you?
Yeah.
Did you talk about that in your act?
I don't. I mean, sometimes I actually like want to start talking about it because I realized if you say diddle, people are like chill with it.
What?
If you say you were diddled or someone was diddled.
Yeah.
Then they're okay with it. Diddle is the word. But well, I think that so many people were fucked when they were kids or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think my experience, of course, is just my own. And it's not as extreme as a lot of other experiences. And I'm not like, and I'm also like a full person and I feel really good. Right. About who I am now. Definitely after the election was a little rough, but
so let's talk about, I don't, by the way, I don't do the kind of show where I try to make people open up.
I mean, obviously, because you got all those fucking one-liners you're trying to throw in. We can get in the way of those. I realize that we're all vehicles for your one-liners.
Yes. Katy Perry is going through a transformation.
Mm-hmm.
Did you read about this? That she was at the Javits Center the day Hillary was supposed to be president,
okay.
And she lost, and she's had this spiritual realignment where she is, you're going, oh God, that I'm talking about. Well, she is pretty talented. And she's, well, but, and she's.
Her songs are good.
Her songs are good. They're catchy.
Yeah, I like her songs.
And she comes from a deeply religious Christian background that she's playing with. In other words, she's rebelling. I think they're Pentecostal or something.
It's always so crazy when you hear those stories.
Right. And I knew that she came from a deeply religious background. I don't know the difference between Pentecostal and evangelical.
Yeah, I don't know
and
shit.
Charismatic, all that stuff. But
I don't even know about my own religion.
But she was campaigning for Hillary. And I remember thinking, knowing her background, this is solely about a woman being president. That given her background, she has to have conservative leanings. This is solely about getting a woman elected president. Is that important? In other words, can you disagree with Hillary on everything? Can you be a pro-life, laissez-faire economy, laffer curve, whatever, whatever, whatever. But because Hillary's a woman, I'm going to vote for her.
I mean, no, I guess not, because she's not elected. No, and women voted. I mean, I don't know how women could vote for someone like Trump, who's like a fucking sexual assaulter and doesn't. I mean, it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. It's absolutely unbelievable.
Right. I don't want to talk about Trump.
But yeah, no, yeah. I, of course, I don't either. But I don't think, I mean, I don't know. I'm not any of those things. And I was for Hillary and I don't know. But I mean, it's weird to like have a stance and stuff. It's scary. There's so many fucking scumbags on the internet and shit. It's like, you know, but yeah, no, I think, what was it, voting with your pussy or whatever everyone was upset about? I'm like, yeah, we can vote for people whoever we want, whenever we want, for whatever reason we want. It doesn't matter. It's no one's business. That's crazy and weird and judgmental, and it's just vote for whoever the fuck you want.
Right. We don't ask men why they're voting for somebody.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. You've been voting for men. I mean, I don't know. She's better than fucking Trump. I mean, it's crazy. Right. What were we talking about?
Father's
queefing
Day.
On some fucking kids? Or... Can we just talk about queefing on kids? What are we talking about?
Is Father's Day's coming up. It's hard for me to shop for my dad, because he's dead, and his neck, I like to buy him like neckties, but his neck size is always changing because he's dead. So I,
was he not cremated?
No, I keep him. He's
just like your, yeah, psycho.
Yeah, I keep dad in the room with me.
Now, your father really wasn't cremated. Your father's dead for real?
Yes.
Okay, and he wasn't cremated?
No.
He was buried in a Jewish cemetery?
We keep him in my basement.
I want to know the truth.
The truth?
Yeah. Do you have like a plot that you're going to go next to him or something?
I
don't know how these Jewish
cemeteries work. I don't tell the truth on this show.
Okay.
I don't. So I can't.
Okay.
He may even be alive for all I know.
Oh, shit.
Everything is. So your dad.
Wow.
What's your earliest?
It's weird that you brought up the topic that you really need to talk about.
Well, I made a joke about
having a father, and now we're like,
how hard it is to shop for my father because he's dead. That was a joke.
But I know, I was just curious.
About my father.
I just had some questions. I'm sorry I care. Are you not used to women asking you questions about yourself?
They're not interested. And that's a
control. You got to get out of that dad zone, dude.
It's a control thing, too.
For you.
Yeah, I control the situation.
By what?
By asking questions. By keeping you.
Then why do you think I asked you a question?
Well, because you're pushing back. But I like to have you back on your feet.
But do you think that maybe I'm trying to control the situation, too?
I know.
We're having an alpha off. I went on a random date with this guy recently. And I went on a random date with this guy recently. Like, I was just at a commercial audition, and we were just both waiting, and he just asked me if I wanted to go see a movie, and I told him I only had Right Now. And so we just impromptu went to this movie. And
what was the movie?
Wonder Woman. Mm. He asked me if I wanted to go see Wonder Woman. It's like, I should have said no immediately. Like, nice try. Don't pander, motherfucker. And he didn't say, do you want to go to a movie? He said that movie. But so we went into the movie, we watched the movie. He was like, he bought the tickets. We walk in, he can't find the theater. He's not looking at the numbers that are right in front of our faces. So I just, as we're going in the escalator, I just go, thanks for the tickets. I'll alpha it from here. I got it. We won't be seeing each other again. But
do you know why men get confused and they can't find the theater? Why do you think he's lost and confused?
He's an idiot. He's stupid.
Okay. Let's think about this for a second. He asked you to a movie.
Right.
And he can't think straight. Why do you think that's going on? Do you think
he thinks he's going to fuck?
How about he's just intoxicated by you? I'm being serious.
I mean, here's the situation. It was like a fun world. I live my life very lean in-y. Anytime there's an opportunity for fun or an interesting story possibly could come out of something, I always do it. So I can see where in his head, this was a crazy whirlwind thing to have happen. To me, it was not average, but it wasn't unheard of for me to do something like that. But it's interesting. It's just when you go on internet dates and you know all this information about people from their internet profile, but you don't know if there's any attraction at all. I had a slight attraction with him in person, but I didn't know any of the other information and it sucked. When I got to know him, I was like, no. He did things I had to send an email. It was 4:30 p.m. while we're watching this movie, and I realized that I hadn't sent an email, that I had to send a work email.
You sent an email?
I had to. It was work. I had to. My company would have been closed by the time I was done. It's I have to fucking work. So I sent it out, and he told me. And also, I'll fucking text. I'll fucking do whatever I want during a movie. I talk during movies. I'm fun. I make jokes. That's how I live.
Hmm.
I'm not I don't do it loud enough to be rude. But if you want to it's just who I am. It's just I don't fucking go to the movies with me if you're like that. I would never tell someone not to do something. I would never silence someone. I don't do that to people. So when people do it to me, so I'm sending this email and he made this big deal about me doing it. And I just was fuck you. And then moments later in the movie, Wonder Woman's about to be awesome, and then the fucking dude makes her wait in the bushes, and I was like, you just did that exact same thing to me. He's like, sorry. It was just things like that where I was like, and then he kept going are you one of those crazy girls? And I was like, are you one of the dudes that calls women crazy? Because I have no interest in that. Get away from me. Mm. I'm fun. Did you not just have so much fun? Was your day not better because of me?
Mm-hmm.
Because you didn't really add that much to mine. And then just saying things. Seriously, I'm like, my day was going to be fun no matter. I have fun at the DMV, dude. But so it was just and then what else did he say that was annoying? Oh, he goes, are you always on? And I was like, yeah, I'm always funny, dude. I will always tell jokes. I will always be laughing and having fun.
Right.
So, and then he thought I was going to text him again. I don't know.
Was he good looking?
He was fine.
Was he good looking before he opened his mouth and you got to know him? Is that, in other words, had he...
He was fine. He was fine. I think it's just so different. I don't think that, for me at least, I can't speak for all women, but I just don't think that we look at guys the same way that guys look at us. So it's not, attractiveness is a confidence or a bunch of different things.
Our producer disagrees.
No. I'm just interested.
Yeah, I just think that I do think it's more it's not about a physical. Obviously he's a commercial actor, so he was fine,
he's a commercial actor.
Yeah, we were just waiting for an audition together. And there were just things he did that I didn't like, and it's not he's not a nice guy or whatever, but I was I already know immediately that this isn't going to.
So ideally, without violating your privacy, what would be your perfect man?
It's hard because I'm trying to break patterns. Because, in the past, honestly, because I was a juvenile delinquent. The guys that I was brought up in Philly. So the guys that I like hooked up with growing up were like gang members. Like the guy I lost my virginity to is like was in prison for years. Like he's got neck tattoos. Like that's my type. So I am trying to not like die in a domestic dispute.
Why? Like I just okay. Can I? Do you mind if I?
Yeah,
can,
go for
I, I'm
it.
Not. By the way, I'm not trying to make you cry or reveal anything about
no.
it. I want to keep this light.
Yeah.
Okay. It's not the. Kind
I mean,
of,
he didn't go to prison because he fucked me. I feel like I have to clarify that.
Okay. Do you think women are attracted to bad guys because it's power? When I was in elementary school and high school, I used to act bad. Like one of like there were bad guys, so I would like gravitate to them because I thought women would be turned on by that. I noticed that the really beautiful women, the girls in high school, and
the beautiful, sexy young girls
were attracted.
The ones you're sexually attracted to. That's
yes.
what you want to say. The young teenagers are sexually
that
currently
I,
sexually attracted to.
No, don't make my ankle bracelet go off.
Live to tape, eh? We'll see about that. We'll see about that.
That girls are attract. I'm saying girls, mm-hmm. not women. Girls, young girls.
Yeah.
Are attracted to bad boys because that is what? Rebelling against their father? Or are they attracted to the power that a bad boy exudes? Is that?
Maybe. I don't fucking know, dude. I don't know. I'm trying to figure it out. I don't really know. And I just was a bad kid. So I was surrounded by bad kids.
When you're on a date, and again, you don't have to answer this question.
Like never been I like randomly have been on that I've been on like two dates in my life. I've never wanted a boyfriend. I've never wanted to be with anyone. It's always an accident. I feel like all my ex-boyfriends always owe me apologies, so it's hard for me. I'm not normal. Like I'm not like other people.
Nobody's normal,
right? But so I can't really speak for one. I don't know, like I guess it's more fun, it's interesting, you're like your emotions are being held suspensefully in the air and you don't know whether they're gonna, I don't know, yeah, it's like to be continued. Is this person gonna call you or treat you well?
So it's drama.
Maybe, I don't know. But I don't, I think now when I hook up with, I usually like hook up with.
What does hook up mean?
Fuck people. But when I usually,
what does that
but it's
mean?
Like, you know, but I don't like, I'm not really like a one man, a one night stand. Like when I drank, I would just, who knows what happened because I was blacked out. But when I mean, God only knows. And my coworkers, a lot of dishwashers. But yikes. No offense to you. I'm not being an elitist, but just like also come on. But come on. So I tend to like. You know, like I'll hook up with someone. I'll have one person I'm sleeping with. Like usually when, if I live in New York, I'll have someone I'm sleeping with in LA so I can see them every few months or every month or whatever and like send them pictures and text them. But now I am like, I have no one right now.
Send them pictures and text them.
Yeah,
and
you don't pictures,
and you don't
text.
Have anybody right now.
No, for the first time like in forever, it feels good.
You're not involved with anybody right
mm-hmm.
now.
I'm completely uninvolved. And I'm just trying to not fuck it up because every time I like,
do you find when men treat you too kindly that you're turned off by that?
When men, not now, I'm in my 30s, fuck that, I want to be treated
I've
nice.
I've noticed that when I'm kind of...
Are you being your mom now?
No, I'm just nothing, I'm just, what?
What else? Tell me more.
I'm asking you a question about, like, do you find when you go out with a man and he's rude to you, you're more attracted to him?
No, that's 20s shit. That's negging. That's like the whole fucking
okay.
book, The Game, where it's
what
like...
What did you do? Your
wait, let's actually talk about The Game, because that leads to the bad boy thing, right?
I'm not a negger.
But you know about it. We know. It's nega. It's nega.
Do we keep that in?
Yeah. That one's fine.
I'm not a... It's negging.
Right. Negging is like the whole process of like where you're supposed to insult a girl's shoes or tell her something's
right.
wrong with her.
So a guy who...
And then so she'll be thinking about
it. I just want to... Before...
Right.
I get fired from my own
you.
Podcast.
It's not just you. Negging is what
so,
it's called.
So when I said I'm not a negger, that means I don't neg.
You're making it so much worse, I feel like.
I just don't want to edit this.
I mean, live to tape, baby.
Okay, go ahead.
You don't have to edit it. You pay a smaller Jew. A younger Jew added it. Are you Jew?
Yeah. Everybody. You're Jewish.
I mean, my last name is, so I guess
everybody's Jewish. It can all be traced back to Abraham.
I gotta say, I'm really proud of you guys. You have really come a far way.
We have.
It's unbelievable. To bounce back from all that horrible stuff and still take over Hollywood, it's like been really incredible.
Thank you.
Well, it's been an honor to work with you guys.
Tell that to Chuck Woolery.
I don't know who that is.
Well, okay.
I'm young. I'm only 14.
Don't make my ankle bracelet hard.
Everyone. It just buzzes when you get a boner. You can leave. It just buzzes when you get a boner.
All right, so let's talk about the game.
Oh, the game. Yeah, so it's like the negging, the whole process. I think when you're younger and you're insecure and you have no clue who you are, and you, as a woman, you're like raised to please men. So it's like just in society and stuff, like it's not even on purpose. My mom is like pretty much a dude. Like she always had short hair. She was the coach of our baseball team. Like she's...
Baseball or softball?
Baseball.
Okay.
No, softball, I played on the boys' baseball team.
So did my daughter.
Yeah. Scary that you have a daughter.
I can talk about that later. They went to the World Series in the Little League.
Oh, cool. In Williamsport, Pennsylvania. The Little League World Series.
No, not that. But in the ooh, local, you know, local Los Angeles.
Yikes.
Shocker,
you're from Los Angeles.
My daughter and her best friend were 13, gorgeous.
Uh-huh.
The guys did not want them on the Little League team.
Right.
Because it's guys. But
they didn't want to use their boners instead of the bat?
Right. Title VII, is that what it's called? Something. There's some title that the women have to play. They were the only two girls in Little League. The boys had to accept it. And it was a screenplay.
Now, how hot are we talking? Her friend. I don't want you to be an incesty. Tell me about this 13-year-old girl. Tell me in detail slowly.
No, I just noticed that it was funny to watch guys around them.
And because they didn't want to have to see them as, do you think they didn't think they were going to play well, or they didn't think that they were going to be?
They do what every heterosexual male does around a woman that they think is pretty. They up their game.
Right.
So I watched this team. That was just a bunch of ragamuffins. The minute my daughter and her friend joined the team,
They started playing. That's so funny.
Yeah.
It's so annoying that pussy is the motivation for all men. We're the pussy, but we also have like our whole lives and feelings and the things that we like and our brains and our ideas.
Maybe it's not pussy.
Maybe it's another mom. I've also found with guys that they want, that a lot of them want to be mommied.
How about just being appreciated and loved by the opposite sex with no judgment?
Where? What the fuck are you talking about?
Anne Margaret.
What nonsense are you talking about?
Do you know
about?
Who Anne Margaret is?
She got her head chopped off?
That would be Anne Boleyn.
I told you I'm not much of an... I'm pretty chill on learning.
Okay. But
my high school had pillows instead of chairs, and they didn't make us read books. We had movie class. This is real.
Really?
Yeah, movie class.
What high school did you go to?
It was called the Krefeld School.
And
it was a juvenile delinquent school, but also
Jacob
autistic kids.
Jacob Krefeld?
What?
Is it named after Jacob Krefeld?
I don't know who it's named after.
Anne Margaret, 75 years old. Absolutely gorgeous. She was in Bye Bye Birdie.
Oh, okay, yeah.
She's still gorgeous. And her husband, Roger Smith, just passed away. And Margaret, he had some debilitating muscular degeneration, and she nursed him.
That's my type. Were you asking earlier? That's my type. Did you ask? That's the answer.
You know what? You're making me...
Are you schwitzing?
You're making me laugh. I get dizzy. And I'm thinking, there's the most, Anne Margaret is, if you're, you know, certain age, baby boomer, fantasy. Anne Margaret is your fantasy.
Right.
And then I think, okay, but I'm also looking for somebody to nurture me and mother me. And here Roger Smith has this muscular degeneration, and she nursed him. Do you think men, and I don't know the answer, would I want Anne Margaret, who's absolutely, she's the...
You don't want her to be wiping your ass.
Or do I?
Well, they've been together their whole lives?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's probably guilt involved. I know that my dad is 9 years older than my mom, 10 years older than my mom. And I know that it's getting, like, different. You know, he's in his mid-70s. And I know that he feels, I think it's, like, upsetting for him that the future is possibly my mom having to take care of him that way. But I think that they love each other, and that's, like, a part of what they're...
Right.
Thing was, I just think it's life is fucked up that you, I've been thinking about it a lot, that you, your family, like all the people that you love, everything's staggered, right? So it's like all these people that you love, these parents, well, for me at least, I have, you know, I love my family so much. It's like my parents are so amazing, and then they're like halfway through their lives or whatever by the time I'm born. And then, you know, you love your pets and they just last for like the most like 15 years. And then you like, you invest in these relationships and they either don't work out, which is also a death where you're like, mm-hmm. all right, I put like so much, especially the ones that you think that are multiple years and stuff where you're like, wow, I really like put a lot into this. And then these are one of the only relationships where you can just completely mm-hmm. cut them out. That always feels weird. And then on top of that, it's like you can meet someone, fall in love, like do the thing that everyone wants, have the kids, do the thing that is the quintessential, apparently the thing people want, which is not what I want, but like that perfect thing, and then that person dies, and then you're single and alone, or you have to watch them die, or in The Notebook you both die at the exact same time.
Nicholas Sparks,
he's more, I would say, like he's almost a reporter because his books are so realistic, but
in The Notebook a couple dies together
at the exact same time.
From what?
Old age.
That has happened.
At the exact same time holding hands?
Oh. Yeah. Well, a lot of people...
Is this Defender Nicholas Sparks movie?
No, I'm just thinking... Slash book? 9/11, a lot of people died at the same exact time.
Wow. Wow.
Just pointing that out. We're cutting that out? We're not cutting that out.
We're not cutting it out. Now we can't cut anything out.
Okay, I was trying to shoehorn a joke.
Listen, 9/11.
You know, it's here's funny. The joke. Ask me, the joke that I sometimes do is, you know, we all die alone unless you're Muhammad Atta.
That's true. It's good.
So I was trying to
shoehorn. I was thinking, yeah, it's like, yeah, we probably won't die alone at this point with what's happening. But what was I going to say?
Well, oh, okay.
Speaking of 9/11, so I worked at a restaurant right down the street at Life Cafe on 10th and B. And it, I worked there for years. I first moved to New York, started working there. I worked there for like maybe 3 years. And then I went out of town and the business went out of business. They shut the restaurant down. It had been around for years. And so I went on the internet, onto the website to see why they shut down. And she said, we chose this auspicious day, September 11th, 2011, to shut down the restaurant because it seemed fitting.
Oh.
Isn't that incredible?
Yes. Yeah.
Like the fucking Twin Towers had gone out of business.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty cute.
To attach something as trivial as your...
Never forget the chicken club sandwich. So funny.
Okay, so you go to movies.
And I don't usually.
But you talk during movies? You text?
I'll talk. Like if I have ADD, so it's like if things need to get done, they got to get done when I think of them or they're not going to get done. I had to email my agent something that was super important. I would have lost $1,500. It's like... Sorry.
Okay, so...
Sorry, everybody that isn't noticing this, except this fucking weird guy that's already starting to do weird little controlling things within 2 hours of me knowing him.
Do you think in relationships we all try to control one another?
Well, I've done like a lot of hallucinogens recently, and everything, all the stuff the medicines tell me is that I'm very controlling and I need to try to give up some of my control.
What kind of hallucinogens? They're now discovering that the brain has multi-universes inside of it.
Yeah, no shit.
I didn't know
We're
that.
We're all vibrations and fizz. Everything's all good. can't believe I got mad at you about the editing thing, and look at us now, because we're fizz.
So you have all these universes inside your brain.
Yeah.
Maybe you're only supposed to use 5% of your brain. When you're on a hallucinogen, how much of your brain are you using? All of it?
I don't know. I just like to take them and then try to like figure out what I need in my life, what I need to work on.
But
mushrooms. I don't know what.
That scares me.
I mean, I've done DMT. I died. I had an experience of dying on DMT. And you have to smoke it out of a crack pipe. So
What's DMT?
DMT is... It's like a white powder, and you have to put it into a crack pipe. What if I just smoked crack? What if it was just crack? But and you have to smoke it out of this like crack pipe ball thing, and it either makes your brain excrete or just is the same chemical that comes out of your brain when you're born and when you die that gives you like the tunnel vision that people always report back when they...
DMT.
Yeah.
So you see like a light at the end of the tunnel.
No, I mean, some people do. There was like a light experience for me, but people close their eyes. They get visited by aliens. People tell them shit. They live in whole different universes. It feels like they're there for days sometimes, and it's only like 5 minutes. For me, mine felt like 30 seconds, and my eyes were open. And I was sitting with my friend and her husband, and I just told this on a podcast in the same room. But and I just had this experience where there was like this bright light behind my friends, and that all of their artwork is like, after they've done a bunch of ayahuasca and a bunch of DMT and stuff, so their artwork is all like psychedelic, and I didn't get it until this moment. But so there was this painting behind him, and it was like glowing behind my friend's husband, and they had all, the minute I took it, everything got sharp and like pixelated looking kind of, and there's this like snake pattern that you see that the Peruvians will actually like sew into fabric and stuff and give to people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like a whole, there's like a snake theme, but it's just sort of like shows you that everything is connected in the whole universe. So everything is like in its place, exactly where it's supposed to be. And then, so I see this light and the other room is getting darker. And then it's just this light behind them. It's getting smaller. And then everything in the room is getting sucked up into the light. And my friend, I watched my best friend get sucked up like one eyeball at a time. Like it looked like the waiting room at, in Beetlejuice,
mm-hmm.
like one eye, like completely stretched out, and then her other eye and the rest of her body went, and then her husband, and then I laid back and I looked at the light. I could feel like my grandmother, like I just like knew it was like death or whatever. And then I felt my body kind of go. I didn't feel my body anymore. And then I was trying to breathe, and then I didn't have to breathe anymore. I just, breathing just stopped needing to happen, and it felt fucking amazing. And it felt like I was everything and nothing. And it kind of reaffirmed some things I had felt not on drugs, kind of had some epiphanies and stuff on my own. And I just woke up feeling like really excited for my dad, because I've always been really worried about him and his age and his health. And I just got excited for him because I know it's going to be good. So Father's
Day. While you were experiencing that, were you aware of it? Or were you totally immersed in it?
I was aware that I was going through it. Like, you still are yourself. You don't, like, lose your mind in any way. Like, I was me in this journey, just, like, watching. Like, I mean, I probably could have talked, but I didn't want to talk. But I did start, like, making jokes the minute I came
out. Okay, so, because I've never done this, because somebody very close to me had a bad experience.
With DMT?
No, just with hallucinogens.
Oh, okay, yeah. There's a bunch of different kinds, too.
Right, and I would never, I just, you know... I'm not going to open up those doors. I like to remain tethered to the earth. But
you'd like them.
Huh?
You'd like them.
I don't know.
Maybe your brain would be too... It's like, I think for people with control, it's actually good, but it is hard. You know, it's a hard thing to choose because you don't know where you're going to go.
And I would be afraid to lose my ego, to lose who I am. I think you're
that's
much
real. No, that's real.
But you're
that.
Strong enough to hold on to who you are. I would be afraid to just completely surrender to the universe.
Well, I got really worried. I mean, I was nervous about that with, I wanted to go right when I was in a 3-year relationship when I was living in Los Angeles that ended in August. I broke up with him. And you know how when you want to break up with someone and you don't, but you, I mean, I like loved him. He was so sweet, but I just knew it wasn't the right thing. And I was like dreading this breakup and not really being completely honest with myself. And so I kept looking for these things. Like I was like, maybe I'll go do ayahuasca. I wasn't doing hallucinogens at this time. I was like, maybe I'll go do ayahuasca or something. And I just wanted to do something that would give me the excuse to break up with him. You know, like I wanted to come back from this thing and be like, you know what? The spirits told me like, peace, you know, it was just mm-hmm. me not having the balls to like hurt someone I loved, you know. And then so I was looking into these Vipassana silent retreats that are 10 days long.
Where you don't talk.
You don't talk for 10 days. You don't write.
Why don't you just
don't
get
look
married?
At people. Or fuck you. call back. But so So like you go 10 days and it's like this weird, I don't know. I've talked to people about it a little bit, but I didn't do that. Cause I was like, that's going to fuck with me too much.
Not to be able to talk
10
for
days 10. For, I mean, I think it would completely reshape who I was as a person.
Could you go 10 days without your cell phone?
No, I can't go 10 days without anything. I mean, Funyuns I've done. That's the only thing I've ever done. And it's very recent.
I don't want to get into the digital detox.
Oh, it's bad. I would like to do something like that because
what's the longest you go without your phone? I can't do it. I can't.
I bring it into the bathroom with me. I put it in a bag. I put it in a bag while I'm in the shower.
Which is why you should never hold anybody's cell phone.
Because it's so dirty.
Bringing back to diarrhea.
Yeah, it's true. There's a lot of diarrhea speckles on my phone for sure.
You know, Diane.
Look how greasy it is.
I know. If we put luminol on our phones, what would we find on it?
We'd find a lot of fucking dick prints. Dudes are just fucking mushroom stamping my phone all the time. It's so annoying. On the subway, I'm like, enough. Fine, I'll give you a dollar. But only because you got it on my niece's face in the background picture.
So relationships, breaking up with a guy.
But so I was, yeah, and I was trying to like use hallucinogens to be like the excuse. And then I went to Ireland and kind of had this out of body experience just being there and like seeing all these old, I went to this church that's 1100 and I am not religious. I mean, Quakerism is like the least religious you can be. I don't believe in God like that or anything. But going there and seeing this church, just the fact that it physically had been there in the 1100s was like mind blowing to me. And I just realized like our insignificance and the fact that like everyone has done this before us, you know, that we're just so caught up in our own shit, but that there have been all these people, and that even though like that thing that I said in Quaker meeting where it's like I was chosen to be me and I'm me, it's like you just have to believe that everyone else feels that way too. And that's
and what about stand-up? When you're on stage, are you satisfying your ego or are you connecting with the audience?
Full connection.
I get that. I think you're right.
Full connection.
And how long did it take you to learn that, or did you know that before you started doing stand-up?
I think it's just been, I've really realized it recently. I think honestly all these hallucinogens I did just made me have like a much more self-aware. And
when was the first time you did hallucinogens?
Well, high school, but I was 14. We did them in the I did acid. The
LSD.
First time I took acid, I was 14. I went to this alternative school and someone had hammered in a human-sized hole in the wall in the glass-blowing studio in the basement. So we got kicked out of the basketball game, came down into the glass-blowing studio in the basement, crawled through the wall, ate acid, and watched the game through the grates in the floor. That was the first time I took acid.
And no freaking.
No, and I'll tell you something. You could always tell who was on acid in my school because they would be looking at the screensavers that were just the stars. Do you remember the stars?
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't freak out. And then I did acid again when I was 14 at my friend's house, and her parents knew we were doing it, and it was fine.
Did you ever freak out on acid?
I didn't. I guess I did it again when I was 16 and I was visiting a friend in the Virgin Islands, and I hadn't been drinking or doing anything. So I had been pretty sober. And so I had not a great trip because I was trying to control it. I was trying to not be fucked up. But we were on their main export in St. Croix is Cruisin' rum, and they use molasses for it. So they have all these giant molasses water towers. So me and my like teenage friends were just hanging up out on top of this fucking water tower, this giant molasses looking water tower or water tower looking molasses tower. And we eat acid. And I remember we had to climb down that fucking little ladder. I mean, it was just so scary and hard. So that was the worst part probably.
Can you stick around?
Yeah, for a little bit. I just got to go pick my friend up.
And, okay.
Yeah.
Let me do your intro.
Okay.
Because we never finished it. Annie Lederman is a stand-up comic who has appeared on MTV's Girl Code, Chelsea Lately, Comedy Central's At Midnight, and This Is Not Happening. Welcome to the David Feldman Show.
Oh, thank you so much. It feels like I've been here for an hour already. It feels like you didn't do the intro on time and this is being recorded later.
We'll be back with Scott Rogowski. He'll join us.
You're listening to highlights from the David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. you sad, pathetic humps.